in 1981, I walked out of an abusive marriage. And looking back, it became very clear to me that what had gone wrong was that I had not been economically empowered. And so I decided that I was going to set up myself on a path that would ensure that that abuse doesn't happen again. But in the meantime, while I was doing my business, it also occurred to me that there were so many women locked up in situations like mine. And so by the year 1985, with my business grown, exporting, married again, I was sponsored by the USAID to come to the US, to be specific, in February of 1987. We traveled across America, sponsored by USAID. And during that trip, I saw the power of unity. And although I had a successful business myself by then, what bothered me most was, what about those women that were locked up in abusive situations, like I had been, who had no means or power to walk away from such abusive situations? So after that visit to the US, I went back home, invited five friends in July of 1987 to look at the modalities of establishing an association of business women. My idea was that we were going to be able to be 100 women, pool our resources together, empower ourselves, fight, be a pressure group to fight government to give us equal opportunity in business, just like our male counterparts. It was also at that point that I drew my mission statement in life. I should have done that earlier, but at that point then I decided that I was going also to spend my life assisting women and youth gain social and political empowerment through business and education, because I truly found out during those years that once a woman becomes economically empowered, particularly at household level, particularly in our economies in Africa, where men eat first, best, and most, women's economic empowerment, businesses for women are benefiting men even more. And so I decided that I was going to spend my life assisting fellow women gain social and political empowerment through business. So that is mainly the reason why I decided that I was going to establish the Joyce Banda, the National Association of Business Women. But in our political situation back home, you couldn't as freely associate. And so when we made an application in 1987, it took us almost two years for us to get the required approval for us to establish that. So that's hence the 1990 establishment of the National Association of Business Women. Yeah, so when I went back home, as I said earlier, I thought I was forming an association of 100 women that were already in business, that were going to pull resources together, that were going to negotiate with the government for equal opportunity in business. I didn't know the actual situation in the country. So we needed to very quickly identify partners that were going to assist me look at the situation as it appeared. Because I remember that the first thing that we did was to go back to USAID to ask for support, to conduct a needs assessment survey, to find out the exact areas of need. And so we went out and conducted that survey in 1990. And the issues that were revealed out after that survey are the ones that influenced the work of the National Association of Business Women going forward. Particularly the fact that only 19% of the women interviewed that entered business had gone beyond primary school. And that only 23% of those women had any kind of property or negotiating skills to ensure that they were making decisions on the lives that, on the issues that affect their lives. For example, the number of children you want to have, for example, whether your girl child can go to school or not. We very quickly discovered that once a woman is economically empowered, those decisions she can make on her own. She can decide to send her child to school. She can decide that a girl child will also go to school. So in 1992, I think, there was a meeting in Botswana where we met CIPE for the first time. And we invited CIPE to come to Malawi. And from there onwards, the relationship with CIPE just grew. And not only did they empower the members of the organization, it started with the leadership, including myself. I traveled to Washington many times. And they created a platform for women in business across Africa to network and to interact. That was a rare opportunity for us to know what other women were doing in other countries. But also they traveled to Malawi and helped us conduct workshops on the ground as well. So CIPE is one of the organizations. USAID opened my door, brought us here, provided the first constitutional development funds that we required in the organization, paid for this needs assessment survey, and then helped us start the organization. But what CIPE did was to help us strengthen the organization, strengthen the capacity of the women at individual level as well as the leadership of the organization to be able to take off. By the year 1997, as the greatest success of the organization, we had reached 50,000 women. And we had provided microfinance to 20,000 of those. What I discovered while running the National Association of Business Women and while growing my own business myself is what I said earlier, that you become independent. You get to a position where you can make decisions that affect your life. But also you begin to look around and see those that are underprivileged. And if it is in you, you also reach out and help those. But what also I did in 1998-99, with the help of USAID, we conducted what we called an impact study for the National Association of Business Women. That impact study revealed that 73% of the women, the 50,000 women that we had supported, had grown out of poverty. And that 84% of the women had gained respect at household level. It also revealed that 40% of the women that we had worked with had moved from informal sector to medium and large. But what bothered me is that the status of women was not changing. That although there were all these opportunities in Malawi, it was at a time when many organizations were mushrooming, but there was very little impact. And in my mind, this is my opinion, I felt that it was the laws. It was the laws that negatively impacted on women and children. And I felt that unless I go and sit where the laws are made, I shall never be able to change the situation of women in that regard. So in fact, it was 1999 was just preparing to enter politics. There were a lot of challenges there because you're changing from being an activist to a politician. So it just couldn't happen overnight. So by the time I stood for office, it was 2004 election. So I stood as Member of Parliament, won, and I was fortunate that when I got into government, I was appointed Minister of Women and Children and straight away started the process of championing the passing of the Domestic Violence Bill, which we did with a lot of challenges, but finally passed it on the 16th of April, 2006. So basically, initially, that's what prompted me. Let me go, I've made my money, I'm fine, I'm empowered. This is what I was looking for. I'm able to make my own decisions, I'm able to make choices. I am married again, but nobody can harass me and abuse me. But what about the rest of the women? Why can't I go to Parliament? I must go to Parliament. I must go and sit where the laws are made. And I'm proud to say at least that one bill passed while I was Minister of Women and Children. I was, leadership grew in me over a long, long period of time. As we have just been talking, even just leading associations and the organizations in my country, was leadership building up in me. So I have always asked myself, how did I feel that day? I was prepared. But as you may have heard, is that I was elected vice president, not president of the country. In Malawi, our constitution demands that you are elected together with your president. And he asked me to stand with him. And he told me that what had influenced that decision was the work that I had done, which is what we've just been talking about. He felt that I had the skills to mobilize, to communicate. I had the commitment to change the lives of fellow women and children. Therefore, I would be better placed to be vice president, to assist him in running the country and changing the status of women and children. Then, initially, that's what that was all about. But the constitution was very clear that if anything happens halfway during your term, then you must be prepared to take over. The constitution says that even the first meeting, when the president is incapacitated or dead, the vice president shall take over and take and lead that process until swearing in. So he had prepared me of that eventuality, because there was one time, I don't know what was happening, but what I remembered was him saying, listen, I made this decision very, very serious indeed, because I know that you can become president, that what this means is that you can become president anytime. But since 2004, when I became cabinet minister, he kept telling me, I will hand over to you in 2014 when I leave after my two terms. So he had planted the seed in me. And it was like in Africa, maybe your grandfather is a witch doctor and he wants to pass on to you his grandson. So you're sitting there and watching him do all this. So he then appointed me foreign minister when he told me this. And said, I'm deliberately doing this because I want to expose you to the world. So I also had 3 years as foreign minister of my country. So when you are your country's first ambassador, then it also creates another unique opportunity for you to interact on the global platform. But also running the National Association of Business Women for 10 years was another very unique opportunity for me to be associated with the world in the business world. And I was very clear, as I am now, what is good for Africa, what is can change the status of women in Africa. I'm very clear in my mind. So going in as vice president, I was ready. But then we had a lot of problems in the first 3 years. So by the time the president passed on the 5th of April 2012, I was not very much aware of what was happening in government. So I went into government that was literally bankrupt. So there was no money, there was no fuel even for a day, there was no food for 2 million people, there was only money for 1 week. I mean, we were off track with the IMF. There was an artificial currency that needed to be straightened out. All those things just could have been worried me. But that's why I'm saying, I think I was prepared, because I went in and just said, well, here I am, here is the task. As the Prime Minister Tony Blair once told me, there's no handover. You just get in there and get to work. So, to respond to your question, I was ready, and I am very proud that as I look back now, when I came in as president in 2012, the economy grew by 1.8%. When I left, the economy grew by 6.3% this year. When I came in, there was money for a week, as I said earlier. When I left, there was money for 3.5 months. When I came in, there was no fuel for a day, even to attend a funeral. The president of Zambia had to send us fuel. When I left, we had fuel at any given time for 15 days, as well as tanks being built in all the regions to store fuel for 2 months. When I came in, there was an abrupt cutting of power. When I left, we had added 64 megawatts to the grid. When I left, we had a model village in every district of the country and a water project in every country. But more importantly, because of having no money for input cover, companies were scaling down and people were losing their jobs. And so companies were operating at 35%. As we left 2 weeks ago, companies were working at 85%, almost full capacity, and employing more people. When I came in, as I said earlier, there was no food for 2 million people. This year, we have harvested 3.9 million metric tons of food. The requirement for the country is 2.9 million metric tons, so 1 million is extra. Being president, as far as I'm concerned, is seeing the people, the ordinary people, improve. And so what I'm proud most about was not only the success story, the 6% growth, the model villages, the extra power, the water, the fuel back, the forex, but also the social programs that I implemented that changed the lives of the people. For example, the week that I was appointed president, that I took oath as president, I established what I called the Presidential Initiative on Maternal Health and Safe Motherhood. And UNFPA announced at the African Union that we have reduced maternal death from 675 per 100,000 to 460. We've also helped ordinary people build houses in every district of the country. But while all this was going on, in 1997, when I was given the award at the Hunger Project, the Africa Prize for Leadership for the Sustainable End of Hunger, which I shared with President Chissano of Mozambique, I went back home with my $50,000 and established what I called the Africa Prize for Leadership for the Sustainable End of Hunger. Well, $50,000 was not much money, but what I have learned over the years that I've worked is that investing in African women, you yield more. There's a multiplier effect. With $50,000, we've worked and established an organization that has benefited, that has reached 1.3 million people. The programs under the Joyce Banda Foundation are education. We have 3 schools. One of them is free. We have 3,500 boys and girls in schools that we sponsor, 500 students in university, 30,000 children in 30 orphan care centers that we give a meal a day and provide nursery education. And we also have 550,000 women in a network of women called Market Women's Initiative Activities and Initiative, acronymed MWAI. And MWAI in our language means opportunity. So they don't know it's an acronym, but it's an acronym for Market Women's Activities and Initiatives in Development. Under this organization, we have mobilized these women to run businesses. And most of them, we target market women. Because I did research and I was looking at the condition of women in the marketplace. What do they go through? And I found that for years and years, they sit there, pregnant, baby is born, the baby will sit on her laps, come rain, come sunshine, no creche, no toilet facilities, no running water, no dwelling place in the market. And for years you can't find her there. And so I wanted to know what was going on, what were the conditions, but also what was happening to their money. Why are they not growing? Why are they not graduating from the marketplace? So the findings of that is a whole report that I cannot go into now, but that is what tempted me, encouraged me to grow that organization and to support women. We have very big projects within the Market Women's Initiative. In fact, the latest one is the growing of cassava and processing of cassava into what you call malt that is used in breweries. And so we are distributing the cassava sticks as seed, and we are also looking at buying a branch, a mobile branch, for a plant for women to process that cassava. We have provided loans, but we have also provided grants to those that are really, really at the bottom to lift them up. What attracted me most to that project is, although I spent time at the Grameen Bank looking at small loans, I also realized that the trickle up had something that I would borrow from, because the trickle up targets even those that are not, that cannot even get loans, that are the poor, very, very poorest, that need a grant to boost them to get to a point where they can get loans. So to cut a long story short, those are the activities of the Joyce Banda Foundation. Moving forward, now that I'm no longer in State House, I have been requested across Africa to provide leadership in promoting business women. Because for me, I'm looking at five pillars. And the five pillars are, first, business. I have proof and I'm a living example of what business can do if only people can invest in African women. The tragedy is that MDG 3, MDG 4, MDG 5 at the UN are the ones that are not going to be to be reached. The targets are not going to be reached by 2015. And sadly, those are the ones that affect women. I have stayed with MDG 3, which is Women's Empowerment, Economic Empowerment and Gender Equality. And I have said for the past 15 years, we must take a holistic approach. We must start with income. We must start with business. We must build businesses for women. Because when women are economically empowered, they look at issues that affect women. They also employ fellow women. And the families benefit. And so I have decided that that's where I'm going to stay. The five pillars are income, which is business, because I have seen that when women are not in business, when they have no income at household level, the girls are not going to school. So girls' education is part of this problem. And if girls are not going to school, if you go a fighter against women dying giving birth like me, I have found that the girls that are dying are between 15 and 19, and it's because they're not going to school, because there's no income at household level. So the third pillar is maternal health. The fourth one is leadership. I have found, and I have lived it, that when you get into leadership as a woman, the first thing you want to notice first is the well-being of fellow women. So therefore, we must begin in Africa, empower women economically, support them to run businesses, because all these other issues are taken care of. And then it is only women who have run businesses, who have money, that will run for office to go to parliament. That's what happened to me. So I am in a very difficult situation where I cannot avoid it. For me, I don't even have a choice but to continue with the fight, to fight for more and more women to run businesses across Africa. And I just sincerely hope, because along the way, for me to move from the door of an abusive husband to the door of State House, I had to depend upon partnerships that I forged on the way. People that came along and supported me. CIPE being one of them. Corporate Council for Africa being another. USAID being another. And so, what I am asking now Africa to do, the world to do, is that the time is now. Africa has positioned itself as the continent for the 21st century. But it will be tragic if the women are left behind. And I just want to ask those same institutions that pulled me and helped me along the way on this journey to come and stand by me as we work together now, not to empower me, but to empower those that need help. That we can, some of us fight, we can pass laws, but at the end of the day, it is the woman herself standing up and saying, enough is enough. I'm not going to be locked up in this vicious cycle of poverty. I'm going to do something about my own situation. And where I come from, back in Africa, there's good leadership there. There are so many Joyce Bandas. Since we started talking, the Joyce Banda Foundation alone has 850,000 youths, 550,000 women, 3,500 in secondary schools, 500 students at university, 30,000 children in orphan care centers. That's 1.3 million people. That's one Joyce Banda. But where I come from, there are so many Joyce Bandas. But I didn't do this alone. I depended on partnerships. So my request is, not only to the women of Africa, the women of Africa must stand up and do something about their situation. And knowing my fellow African women, they're not just sitting back there and waiting for handouts. They are ready. They know what to do to change their situation. So my request is now to the international community to say, you have to be like CIPE. You have to come on the African continent and identify local leadership. The way CIPE came to Africa and identified me, identified Genevieve in this country, I can mention names and names that CIPE has worked with on the continent of Africa. When that happens, 10, 15 organizations come there and work together in smart partnership, respecting us, mutually understanding one another, that being poor is not being stupid, but that we also know what we should do to change our situation. And work together and hand in hand, we shall yield more. And I have hope. So I cannot only talk to African women, I must talk to both. I must talk to the international community to say, come, but don't come to do it for us. Come to work with us so that we can change the situation and we can do it faster if we have, if we stand united, holding hands, rather than them coming to Africa and trying to do it on their own. I have no doubt whatsoever that in this century, the 21st century, we will do it together, because I know that our men realize that they cannot achieve much if they leave the women behind. In any case, we are 52%. And from what I was told, the last time I checked, the other half was also brought into this world by women.